Hello and welcome to EJC News Focus. The European Cancer Congress in Amsterdam was packed with presentations on new molecularly targeted agents. The development and eventual use of these drugs depends, of course, on sophisticated diagnostics. And ESMO President Martin Piekaar expressed concerns about barriers in Europe to the development of diagnostics.
I think we badly need a new approved diagnostic test in this era of precision medicine. Everybody talks about personalized medicine, precision medicine. Well, this starts with a very good diagnostic test, and I'm worried because, first of all, I see some reluctance in Europe regarding the development of new diagnostic tests. Oncologists seem to be very conservative, very attached to the old way of doing things. And although I greatly value pathology, I think pathology is important, I can see, for example, in the United States, a much greater enthusiasm at adopting some molecular tests. An example that I can see are these multi-gene prognostic signatures in breast cancer, which are helping the oncologist to identify women with a very, very good prognosis, not needing chemotherapy. The uptake of this test has been very slow in Europe as compared to the United States. So we need to change the culture. We need to change the regulatory path because there is very little incentive today for companies to invest in diagnostic tests. The regulatory path is not very clear, and this generates anxiety and demotivates essentially people to invest in these new diagnostic tests. And we are going to need diagnostic tests giving us information on multiple targets, because we will no longer be able to afford a diagnostic test for a single marker. We will have to look at a number of molecular aberrations in the tumor to increase the chance to find one that is present in the tumor and that we can then match with an interesting drug.
Are there differences across Europe? Are some countries more reluctant than others?
I think the reluctance is a little bit everywhere in Europe. I have not seen clear differences, and still today there are only a few countries, I think, which have, for example, endorsed the Oncotype DX test. So a cultural change is needed there, and also perhaps some thinking into what is needed, what is the amount of work that is needed to start embracing a new diagnostic test. Because if you look at the time it has taken us to validate MammaPrint, which is a multi-gene prognostic signature for early breast cancer, this is more than 10 years effort. And so that's far from being optimal. I don't think that we can afford spending so much time, so much money on the validation of a single molecular test. We will have to probably adopt some thinking of our American colleagues who are considering that if you can validate a molecular test on archival material collected in the context of past randomized clinical trials, this is providing already enough evidence that the test is robust and that you can start utilizing it.
Is that accepted by the FDA in the States?
Yes, I think that there has been some progress there made at the level of regulatory bodies in the United States, and that it's now time for Europe to start coming up also with some better approval mechanism for this diagnostic test.
What needs to happen?
I think what I would like perhaps is a real brainstorming between FDA, EMA, and clinicians, and pharma, and try to come up with a vision. a vision on how we can push molecular diagnostics more than we do today. And you know, we have this increasing segmentation of tumors into very, very small disease entities, all characterized by molecular aberrations. So if we don't change this, I cannot see how we are going to be able to apply personalized oncology in clinical practice. It will only be possible in the context of clinical trials. So that's why we think, we are, several of us are thinking that this is a high unmet need.
A good example of the central role of diagnostics in cutting-edge clinical research is the SHIVA trial. Christophe Letourneau presented data on patients whose treatment is determined only by the molecular profile of their tumor.
So the SHIVA trial is a proof of concept randomized trial. This trial is histology independent. So in that trial can be included patients with any type of cancer that are refractory to standard of care.
How many patients have been enrolled and what happens to them?
So far we have enrolled 370 patients. The goal is to treat 200 patients. So why do we need to enroll more than 200 patients? The first reason is because not all patients will have a druggable molecular abnormality for which we can propose them a targeted agent. And the second reason is that some patients deteriorate after the molecular profile has been established and cannot be randomized in the second part of the study. So patients sign a consent form so that we can perform a biopsy in order to establish the molecular profile of the tumor. If a molecular abnormality is detected, then the patients are randomized between the matching targeted agent among 11 targeted agents that are already on the market versus conventional chemotherapy we would give them if they had not participated in the trial. So in fact, patients are only receiving targeted agents that are on the market but not approved for their disease.
Are there any indications yet of how it's going?
74 patients have been randomized. So I can only tell you that we have seen responses with some drugs, with some targeted agents patients would not have received outside of the trial. But now it's too early to tell whether, you know, that strategy to perform biopsy and to give the matching targeted therapy improve the outcome of this patient as compared to conventional chemotherapy. And we'll need to wait at the end of the trial to get the final analysis in terms of progression-free survival.
When will that be?
It will be a maximum in 2016 and hopefully a year before, because the accrual is very fast.
How important are diagnostic tools going to be as medicine develops?
High throughput technologies are very important for the future, because nowadays, so we only look at a single abnormality at once. But for the patient, it's important that we know more than one molecular abnormality for every cancer, so that we can guide the patient to a specific clinical trials or do some more analysis. So I think in the future, even for the patient, it will be fundamental to get a whole picture of the molecular profile of their tumor and not only, you know, one or two molecular alterations.
What happens if we don't give diagnostics this priority?
A first possible consequence could be that this will delay the approval of the targeted drug. Because, of course, many of these targeted drugs need companion diagnostic test. A second problem that I can see is that people could perhaps be tempted to start using mediocre diagnostic procedures. And that would then automatically lead to overtreatment and undertreatment of patients. So the importance of powerful, very robust diagnostic test cannot be underestimated.
And with thanks to Martine Picard and Christophe Letourneau, that's it for this month's EJC News Focus.